Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
So we continue to read from Bhagavad Gita 15, chapter, text 15. How many times this lecture? How many days? Yesterday also? This verse? Huh? Huh? No, they told me it's again 15. Huh?
Yesterday is not 15. Yesterday is not 15.
15. What? Yesterday was?
15.
15. Today not, but today again 15. Organizers say again is 15. Or you like 16? Who was here yesterday? You?
I was here.
You? No, we can hear it.
Yesterday was 15. I don't know today what is
15. Huh?
Regarding today, I do not know. Today, I do not know what is next.
Okay, we will speak also 15. Because that's what I heard. It's a very nice verse. Sarvasya chaham riti sannivishto.
Sarvasya chaham riti sannivishto.
Matak smitya jnanam apohanam cha. Vetashta sarvai aham eva vedyo.
Vetashta sarvai aham eva vedyo.
Vedanta krit veda vid eva chaham. Loki, Gita is there. Sarvasya chaham riti sannivishto. Matak smitya jnanam apohanam cha. Vedashta sarvai raham eva vidya. Vedanta krit veda vid eva chaham. Sarvasya chaham riti sannivishto. Matak smitya jnanam apohanam cha. Vedashta sarvai raham eva vidyo. Vedanta krit veda vid eva chaham. Sarvasya chaham riti sannivishto. Matak smitya jnanam apohanam cha. Vedashta sarvai raham eva vedyo. Vedanta krit veda vid eva chaham. Sarvasya chaham riti sannivishto. Matak smiti jnanam apohanam cha. Vedashta sarvai raham eva vedyo. Vedanta krit veda vid eva chaham. Sarvasya cham riti sannivishto. Matak smitya jnanam apohanam cha. Vedashta sarvair aham eva vedyo. Vedanta krit veda vid eva chaham. Atiches.
Sarvasya
chaham riti sannivishto. Matasmiti jnanam apohanam cha. Vedashta sarvairaham eva vedyo. Vedanta krit veda viteva cham. Sarvasya.
Sarvasya.
Of all living entities. Cha. And. Aham. I. Riti. In the heart. Sannivishta. Situated. Mata. From me. Smriti. Remembrance. Jnanam. Knowledge. Apohanam. Forgetfulness. Cha. And. Vedai. By the Vedas. Cha. Also. Sarvai. All. Aham. I am. Eva. Certainly. Vedya. Knowable. Vedantakrit. The compiler of the Vedanta. Vedavit. The knower of the Vedas. Eva. Certainly. Cha. And. Aham. I. Translation and Purport by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. I am seated in everyone's heart, and from me comes remembrance, knowledge, and forgetfulness. By all the Vedas I am to be known. Indeed, I am the compiler of Vedanta, and I am the knower of the Vedas. Translation and Purport. Purport by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. The Supreme Lord is situated as Paramatma in everyone's heart. And it is from Him that all activities are initiated. The living entity forgets everything of his past life, but he has to act according to the direction of the Supreme Lord, who is witness to all his work. Therefore, he begins his work according to his past deeds. Required knowledge is supplied to him, and remembrance is given to him, and he forgets also about his past life. Thus the Lord is not only all-pervading, he is also localized in every individual heart. He awards the different fruitive results. He is worshipable not only as the impersonal Brahman, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the localized Paramatma, but as the form of the incarnation of the Vedas as well. The Vedas give the right direction to people so that they can properly mold their lives and come back to Godhead, back to home. The Vedas offer knowledge of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, and Krishna in his incarnation as Vyasadeva is the compiler of the Vedanta Sutra. The commentation of the Vedanta Sutra by Vyasadeva is in the Srimad Bhagavatam gives the real understanding of Vedanta Sutra. The Supreme Lord is so full that for the deliverance of the conditioned soul is the supplier and digester of foodstuff, the witness of his activity and the giver of knowledge in the form of Vedas and as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, the teacher of the Bhagavad Gita. Is worshipable by the conditioned soul. Thus God is all good, God is all merciful. Anta pravishta shashta jananam. The living entity forgets as soon as he quits his present body, But he begins his work again, initiated by the Supreme Lord. Although he forgets, the Lord gives him the intelligence to renew his work where he ended his last life. So not only does a living entity enjoy or suffer in this world according to the dictation from the Supreme Lord situated locally in the heart, but he receives the opportunity to understand the Vedas from him. If one is serious about understanding the Vedic knowledge, then Krishna gives the required intelligence. Why does he present the Vedic knowledge for understanding? Because a living entity individually needs to understand Krishna. Vedic literature confirms this. Yo sau sarvai vedair giyate. In all Vedic literature, beginning from the four Vedas, Vedanta Sutra and Upanishads and Puranas, the glories of the Supreme Lord are celebrated. By performance of Vedic rituals, discussion of the Vedic philosophy, and worship of the Lord, in devotional service is attained. Therefore, the purpose of the Vedas is to understand Krishna. The Vedas give us direction by which to understand Krishna and the process of realizing Him. The ultimate goal is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Vedanta Sutra 114 confirms this in the following words. Tatu Samanvayat. One can attain perfection in three stages. By understanding Vedic literature, one can understand his relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. By performing the different processes, one can approach him, and at the end, one can attain the supreme goal, who is no other than the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In this verse, the purpose of the Vedas, the understanding of the Vedas, and the goal of the Vedas are clearly defined.
Sarvasya jaham riti sannivishto mataksmitya jnanam apohanam cha vedashta sarvairaham eva vedyo vedanta kritveda vid eva chaham.
I am seated in everyone's heart, and from me come remembrance, knowledge, and forgetfulness. By all the Vedas I am to be known. Indeed, I am the compiler of Vedanta, and I am the knower of the Vedas.
Omakyatim ranyasya gananchana salakyam chakshurun militam yena tasma shigrave namaha sichatane manobistam stapitam yena bhutale svayam rupa katamayam datati svapatantikam anchakalpa trubhyascha kripasindabhevacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha.
Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhaktavrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So, it is clear Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he knows everyone. All the living entities he knows. Why he knows? Because he's their father. He's the father of uncountable living entities. They're all his part and parcels. Everything is emanating from him. And as such, he knows everyone. He knows the history of everyone. He knows the desire of everyone. Because he's not only the father, he also is simultaneously living in the heart of all living entities as the super soul, Paramatma. There's Atma and Paramatma. two souls. We are the singular, singular soul. We know something about ourselves, more or less. Sometimes we don't even know much because we are so much covered by ignorance and false ego that we don't even know who we are actually are and what we like and what we don't like. How we should plan our life to make it something good out of it. So sometimes we are not even aware about that. Therefore life is a school, we say. Life is a school where we can learn how to actually progress, to learn how to know ourselves, to understand ourselves, our real self, so that we can make a nice plan to make the best out of that what we have gotten from previous life. It is described, human form of life is very, very rarely attained. It is... there are 8,400,000 species of life, and most of the living entities they take birth in not human forms, insect form, tree form, plant forms, beast, animals, birds, fish, so many different species of life, and in every species of life there's a living entity, there's a soul. And the soul is all the same. It's not an animal soul, a fish soul, a plant soul, and a human soul. The soul is the same. It's Atma. Everywhere it's described, Atma. It's the same in all the species of life. So after the evolution process of the material nature, under the guidance of the super soul, the Purusha, who is simultaneously the creator of the universe, and also enters the universe to maintain it, and to guide the living entities to their future destinations, and with a plan ultimately and hopefully that the living entity will turn one time the face towards the Lord, and will surrender to the Lord, and will. Have a desire to stay with the Lord always. And then is the Vedas say, then the misery is finished. As long as we don't do that, turning our face towards Krishna, we have to live in ignorance. We are in darkness. We cannot know ourselves. Still, the Lord, although we have forgotten Him, although we are in this material nature, one body after another, since time immemorial, the Lord never has given up the living entity. Although we always turn the back against Him, we don't want to have anything to do with Him. Still He's guiding us. That shows His well-wishing nature, that He always wants to help the living entity. Even in giving him bad karma, not only good karma. Like for example, if somebody is a rascal, to give him a reward for that, you know, will not make him a honest or a good person. So he has to get a punishment, and for that punishment, you know, hopefully he will learn something, he will be rectify, he will regret, and he will promise, I will from now on not be a rascal anymore. But because he's in habit all the time, even if he makes promises and gets hard lessons by the material nature, who is acting under the Lord's guidance, Maya Dakshena Prakriti Suyate Sacharacharam, everything is moving according to the Lord's direction. Maya is not independent. So when the living entity, although it gets hard lessons, still, he will maybe not learn from one lesson, so he gets lesson again and again. Hard school, the school of hard knocks, until he maybe learns. Punishment, Krishna doesn't like to punish the living entity. He doesn't like to keep the living entity, his eternal part and parcel, in suffering condition. that sometimes he has to put him in a suffering condition so that it wake up. Of course, suffering will not wake you up. It's not punishment. It's not that punishment makes a criminal up, but it makes him doubtful. Thoughtful. It makes him aware. Oh, I don't want to suffer. I actually suffer because of my mischievous activities. So let me become a good person. But because he has habit and he doesn't learn how to become a good person, he makes the same nonsense again and again, so that he's again and again put in difficulty and in prison. And the Bhagavatam says, even if you're a good person, the Super Soul also guides the good person and gives him good rewards again and again. But he will not give him liberation, because the good rewards or the good activities keep the living entity in the material world. He doesn't want to come out of prison. He doesn't want to come out of the cycle of burden death, repetition of burden death, samsara. So he wants to improve his material life standard of life. Therefore, he's doing good activities with the hope will get better and better karma for that, good karma. The criminal, he will get bad karma. And the good person, pious person, will get good karma. But both are in prison. First class prisoner, or third or fifth class prisoner, is the same. Other feels maybe a little better because I'm first class. I'm in prison in Switzerland, you know, with everything beautiful. Everything, all comfort. Good money, good jobs, good furniture and house and everything, you know, and people also good, nature good, air good, water still good. You can drink directly, no problem. So, and he thinks, oh, it's very nice, I'm in Swiss prisoner. But he's still in prison. He's still conditioned by the material nature. I'm Swiss. Other one thinks I'm German, I'm American. I'm Indian, I'm Turkish, I'm black, I'm white, I'm red, etc. And according to that, you know, we consider ourselves, we belong to somebody, to a certain nation, certain family. But this is actually all built up out of ignorance. Out of ignorance, bodily concept of life, and nationalism, or country, the consciousness that I belong to a certain nation, country, is also ignorance. It's extended bodily concept of life, like family, so nation, so it's all bondage. As long as we are in this bondage of a concept, material concept of life, we have to stay in the material world. But who is the witness? Who is deciding that? If we stay, where to stay? And how life will go on? What kind of destiny we'll get in next life? Of course, for the atheists, it's no problem. They don't believe in next life. They think this is anyway not possible. It's only one life and then it's finished. Therefore, we can do whatever we like. We don't have to be afraid of punishment. Everyone gets the same result. Dead. Finish. But that's another ignorance. The ignorance of the soul thinks, I'm dying. The conditioned soul who is embodied, considering the body as the self. He thinks in ignorance, I'm dying. But actually, in fact, it's not I'm dying. My body is dying. I'm changing just my dress. And according to my activities, how much salary work I'm doing, you know, I can afford a better dress or a worse dress than I have now. But we have to get a new dress, according to our activities. So according to activities, they're bringing us to the next, give us the next result. But the one who is deciding that, because in the time of death, as Prabhupada is pointing out, we forget everything. It cannot remember when you take a new body that you had already a previous body where you were suffering or enjoying. It takes then this new body and relatives and etc. etc. as my new family, as my real thing, as my all in all. And forget all the other relatives and bodies what I had, what I was so much attached and never want to let it actually go on, let it go on my own. So now I have a new body. But again, the same story goes on. Identification with the body. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, today his appearance day, Sharanagati. First, one of the first songs in Sharanagati is Danya. Danya means humility. Out of sheer humility, very humble, in humble mood, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he prays like an ordinary soul, suffering soul, who took birth in the womb of mother, of a certain mother. He says, I realize that I'm a soul. In the Bhagavatam is stated that the living entity is aware in the womb about his position. And he even has a darshan of the Lord. He gets some kind of information. And he even makes a promise, He makes a promise because he doesn't want to suffer. And he sees the beauty of the Lord. Oh, when I take birth, I will not want to take birth again. I will act in such a way that I will not take birth again. That means I will become a devotee. But then as soon as he takes birth, forgets. Who gives you the forgetfulness? The forgetfulness is given the Lord to the agency of material nature. Because the Lord is all-penetrating, He's in every atom. He's also in your intelligence, He's in your senses. He's everywhere. That means He's a real, big brother watching you. A spiritual big brother watching you. He has His sensors everywhere, in every cell of our existence, of our bodies. Therefore, He directs everything through the senses and through the mind and through the intellect. And therefore, the Lord, He can give you memory for information. It's a symptom of intelligence, memory. It's not the mind. Mind is only accepting and rejecting. But it's actually the intelligence. It's a more finer, subtle part of our body who is actually has memory and also forgetfulness. Forgetfulness is also a sign of the intelligence. So you can forget. Because just remember, if you would have already so many lifetimes behind you, all kinds of different lifestyles, and everything is going on in your body now. You remember everything, what happened in your let's say 10 lives before. Everything is going on in you. How you can live your life? How you can live your present life if you remember simultaneously 10 other lives before now? If you will not forget, therefore it's got Lord's mercy that it gives us forgetfulness. That we can live that life what we live now. And the life what we what we get now is the result of what we earned from past life, from previous life. Good or bad, animal, human form, plant form, whatever. The Lord is giving us the remembrance, the desire Actually, they can have a little desire and a little work in a certain direction. Then the Lord will give us the remembrance, and He will give us also forgetfulness in the same time. Because He works through the senses. The senses are also His parts of the universal form. As is described in the Bhagavatam, in the second and in the third canto, the universal form contains everything. All senses are there, all elements are there, all subtle elements are there, false ego, mind, intellect, the senses, the working senses, the knowledge acquiring senses, the sense objects, the five gross elements, earth, water, fire, air, ether. It's all there. It's all contained in the universal form. But and all the demigods, they become devatas. That means they become controllers of different sense organs. Like the sun is a control of the organ of sight, eyes. The tongue is under control of Varuna, water god. And so in this way, the moon is controlling the mind. So there are different demigods, devatas, who are in charge for the different sensual and mental functions. And who are the devatas? The devatas are adidaivaka. Adidaivaka, that means they're representatives of the Supreme Lord. They're empowered by the Lord for the material functions, for the gigantic material affair. They're all His agents. Like a state has so many agents, so many representatives. They all represent the law of the state, the foundation of the state, the president and the government. It is spread all over the country. So in this way, the state is controlling through different personalities. So in the same way, the universe is controlled by the different representatives, the devatas, who are representative of the super soul, of the Purusha. And they're all situated in the different parts of His body. But the universal form didn't move. The mind was there, created, the senses were created, ears, nose, eyes, mouth, skin, hairs, water, air, fire, ether, everything was there. But the universal form didn't move. Brahma also became manifested. Universal form didn't move. False ego became manifested. Universal form didn't move. So when the universal form, the Virat Rupa was moved, when Chitta entered. Chitta means the consciousness. That means the life of the body is not our ego. It's not our mind. It's not our intellect. It's not our senses. It's not any one of the devatas who are controllers of all the functioning of our organs and senses. It is the consciousness. And the consciousness is coming from Purusha, from the Super Soul, from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He's the original consciousness. Nitya Nitanam, Chetanas Chetananam, Eko Bahunam, Yovidadati Kaman. So there are two eternals, Nityas, two Atmas, the Supreme and the living entity.
They're identical. Both are eternal by nature. But one is subordinate and the other one is controller. Eko bahunam, yo vidadhati kaman. He fulfills the desire of everyone. He is that. Therefore, he gives results. Why sometimes somebody can get a big result without big endeavor, and others they make big endeavor and has no result, only failure, no job, no good education, no success. Everything he has to struggle and do like anyone else. But others become successful, others not. Some blame God. Oh, God is partial. God is partial. He helps somebody, he benedicts somebody, and others he doesn't benedict. He makes them suffering. That means he's partial, so I become atheist. I don't like such a God. So I revolt against him. I boycott him. Because we don't understand that the Lord is acting according to our activities, our desires from previous many lives. What gives us the life and the result now? So it doesn't come from one day to another. Also in spiritual life, Srila Prabhupada, for example, he told that everyone who becomes a devotee in this time, actually he must already taken up devotional service in previous life. But you remember that you did devotional service or some kind of spiritual activities, Sukritina spiritual activities in previous life? I don't remember. So it means we have forgotten. But the super soul didn't forget. So he remembers. And therefore he gives us again the link, meeting with spiritual master or with devotees, giving us a book, that we meet a book distributor, that we can somehow or other come in contact with devotees. And in this way, take up the process of chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and learn the Vedas. So the Vedic scriptures are actually meant to understand that Supreme Personality, our eternal well-wisher, who himself is the universe and is also simultaneously also in every living entity, in everyone's heart, in every atom. And he guides directly or indirectly everything. Even Brahma, when he took birth on the lotus, he didn't know about his identity from previous day of his life. He forgot everything during the night. He forgot. So he could not recognize or he could not remember what is my activity today. What is my duty today? So it is ultimately the Supreme Lord. After Brahma sat in lotus asana there, position, and started to meditate on the advice of the Lord to perform tapasya, that the Lord revealed to him this Vedic knowledge and he initiated him in the process of devotional service, because he was satisfied with the attempt of Brahma to find out about the purpose of his life, the duty of his life. Also, people, they are not aware. We don't think, what is my duty today? We do whatever we think that is my duty. Not guided by scriptures and by the super soul and by the spiritual master. And not by authority. Yes, we accept authority, but they're mostly blind. Fallible soldiers. Blind men. And we are blind. And we are following the blind. So the result is catastrophe. So we have to follow the one who has knowledge. It is the sarvair aham eva vidya vedanta krit veda vid eva chaham. Or another place, Bhagavatam says, Natevi tu svarta katim hi vishnum. durashaya bahya artamanina andhair and andhair upamiyan upaniyamanas te pisha tantra urudhamni badha.
So the living entity embodied in this material world is blind, and we are following blind men, blind leaders, and the result is we're falling down a cliff because we don't see the direction, and the blind leader also don't see the direction. But we have to follow even animals, everyone accepting leader. Nobody can say I have no leader. Even if you have no leader, then you follow your mind, you follow your wife, you follow your children, accepting them as leaders. Everyone has somehow or other have to accept leadership. I mean somebody to whom we follow. Like Bhaktivinoda Thakur, therefore he says, you know, now I took birth. And I went through education. Actually, first I grew up with my family members, and they all like me very much. They love me. They gave me so much love and affection. And ultimately, I forgot everything what I promised in the womb, and what the thoughts what I had in the womb. I thought, oh, this life is very nice. All these people around me, they like me so much. Oh, it's so nice. Then I went to education, then I went to higher education, and I became very much puffed up, very much proud. I know something now. I don't have to now follow the Vedic scripture or Hindu scriptures. I don't have to study our religion, because this is from bygone ages, from the sages and Puranas. This is not relevant now today. Now we have to study computer science and something very practical to earn money. Every one of us, you know, what kind of job you will learn, or your father will tell you, we should learn to earn money. He will tell you, no, become a programmer, computer science, study, go to university, study like that, technology, like that. And so in this way we become very much proud on our education and our progress of material knowledge. Although actually we don't know who we are, and what is my duty, what is the goal of life, how life will go on in the future, we don't know, because we only take the life now. That means it's ignorance. This knowledge is built up of ignorance, and even the Lord is giving this kind of knowledge. That means through Maya. Maya is also the Lord's agent. So Maya gives you this kind of material education, knowledge. Ultimately, even liberation, another trick of Maya. So the living entity become very much bewildered by education. Even sometimes in the terms of Vedic knowledge, with the promise of attaining higher planets, Svargaloka, like that. Longer life, more happy life, auspicious life. But it's also still material. For Sri Vyasadeva, he was not satisfied when he compiled the Vedas and the Mahabharata. Only after he compiled the Srimad Bhagavatam, he felt satisfied. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he points out through his own life, putting himself in our position of conditioned soul, that now I'm going through so much education, and then I create a family, I earn my money, I maintain family, have children and grandchildren, house, car, etc. And I become more and more attached. And I'm forgetting
more and more about my real identity as an eternal servant of Krishna. And then the end, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he cries. Now I'm old man. I'm crying because I didn't use my human form of life to solve the problem of birth, old age, disease and death, to find out about my real position. Now I'm crying because now it's too late on my own. I cannot save myself. Therefore he prays to the Lord, "Oh my Lord, only you can help me. You can accept me and guide me further. I'm helpless, I'm very poor." So that is the fallen condition a devotee is putting himself in, the Sharanagati process, in the surrendering process. And Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he gives a very nice example of his own life, how much he was surrendered and how much he was searching after the absolute truth. Not everything went easy. Although, let's say he's acharya. But even if one is an acharya, he has to go also through family life, he has job, so many intrigues, struggling for money, he had so many diseases, even also in old age he got so many diseases, terminal diseases, fever, you know, every day, all the time fever. After a certain age he got fever all the time, non-stop, the fever never went down. And you can imagine, you know, if you're always in fever condition, over 37, 38, every day, for years and years, it doesn't go down. Chronical fever, Bhaktivinoda Thakur had. But he didn't give up. He didn't doubt it on Krishna. And he accepted this as Krishna's mercy. And he didn't thought about only about his body, because he was on transcendental position, always thinking about how to find out books about Lord Chaitanya, like Chaitanya Charitamrita, Srimad Bhagavatam. This was very rarely available. There was no libraries who sold Bhagavatam at that time, or Chaitanya Charitamrita. So there were no book distribution going on. So he had to go and find out everything on his own. Where to find out where is a bona fide Srimad Bhagavatam, where is Chaitanya Charitamrita? He had to search for these books. And Krishna, he revealed all these different books to him, although they were not available on the market. Krishna arranged that he ultimately got these books. And Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur wrote so many books on his own, on the basis of these books, of the Vedas. Because the Vedas are the foundation of knowledge. Without Veda, there's no knowledge. Therefore, if we want to know about Krishna, we have to consult with the Vedas. We have to consult with all the Vedic literatures and understand the Siddhanta of the Vedic literature. Like Krishna says in the 11th canto, 21st chapter of the Uddhava Gita, that actually people don't understand me. There's nobody who understands my identity through the Vedic process of Karma Kanda and Jnana Kanda. Only he himself knows himself. And therefore only that knowledge what Krishna reveals is real knowledge. So therefore we should accept. And Krishna gives us knowledge in the Bhagavad Gita and the Vedas and Vedanta Sutra, Srimad Bhagavatam. It's also Krishna, Dvaipayan Vyasadev, Bhadra Narayan. Vyasadev. It's Krishna himself. Idam Bhagavatam Nama Puranam Brahma Samhitam Uttama Shloka Charitam Chakara Bhagavan Rishi. The Lord in the form of a rishi, of a great sage, who compiled the Srimad Bhagavatam. Therefore, Vedavyasa, he says, after compiling Vedanta Sutra, after compiling Srimad Bhagavatam, there is no other literature. What is the need of other literature if we have the Srimad Bhagavatam? That means it's the king, the Grantharaj, the king of all literatures. So either Krishna directly, he Veda Narayana Sakshat, he gives Vedic knowledge, and he gives further Vedic knowledge, elaborated Vedic knowledge, in form of the Puranas, Mahabharata, Vedanta Sutras, and Srimad Bhagavatam, especially through his incarnations in Vyasadev, who is also Krishna, Krishna Dvaipayan, Vyas. So he's very special. There are many different Vyasas in different days of Brahmas, in different Manvantars, but this Vyasa is very special, and it's Krishna himself. Because who else than Krishna himself can write such a wonderful literature like Mahabharata and Srimad Bhagavatam ultimately and the Vedanta Sutras? This is a superhuman activity. There's not ordinary human who could write such a literature. It is therefore completely transcendental. It is aparoishaya. It's not man-made. And only because of this literature nowadays, we have the opportunity to understand what is our sambandha, our relationship with Krishna. Who are we? Who is he? What is our relationship with him and to the material nature? And how to engage this material nature in Krishna's service? And engage in abhideya and ultimately engage, attain some abhideya prayochana, that means love, our real purpose of life, prema pumarta mahan, love to Krishna. So that's the ultimate goal of life. And the Vedas, they teach us these processes, three processes, sambandha, abhideya, prayochana, these three processes. And only in the human form of life we can learn this process under the guidance of spiritual master and the Vedic literatures. Therefore, Lord Chaitanya, he told to Sanatana Goswami, the living entity cannot, save himself from this repetition of birth and death and suffering condition. Therefore, the merciful Lord, he sent the Vaishnava literatures and the Vaishnavas, the Guru Vaishnava, and the scriptures. And only by the Veda Shastra and by the mercy of the Vaishnava that they can learn from the Vaishnava about the process of the Vedas. Because only a Vaishnava can know, only Krishna and the Vaishnava empowered by Krishna actually knows Krishna and the process how to attain him, this truth. Only Krishna and somebody empowered by Krishna. It's not an academic process what we can learn somewhere. It's only if Krishna is revealing it, either directly by himself in the form of the Bhagavad Gita, or then through his Bhagavata devotees, by his acharyas, representatives. And they teach us by their own example, by their own words and example, they teach us how to serve Krishna, how to attain Krishna, how to please him. And therefore, to follow these devotees means to follow Krishna. We are not able to follow Krishna directly, but we can follow Krishna's devotees. Tomorrow is Haridas Thakur, disappearance day. Haridas Thakur, he says, when Lord Chaitanya wanted to give him a blessing, Mahaprakash, 24-hour ecstasy, Lord Chaitanya was calling all the devotees, and then he also called Haridas. Haridas, what do you desire? Come here. I fulfill any desire what you like. Hari Das said, my dear Lord, I have only one desire. Because I'm very fallen. I'm not deserving directly to be your associate. I cannot pray for that even. I feel too much fallen, too much insignificant, and too much low. Therefore, I only can pray that I can always eat the remnants of foodstuffs from your devotees. But then he contemplated and he said, oh, actually, I'm even too fallen for that. I'm even fallen for that. I don't even deserve the remnants of the devotee's food. I only pray that I can become their dog, the dog of your devotees. And whatever remnants of prasad that they throw to me, I will accept with happiness. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was very satisfied with the humble prayer of Haridas Thakur. And he told him, I will tell you a secret now, my dear Haridas. Because you forgot. Or maybe you think nobody knows about it. But I know about it. Because you remember maybe when you were a younger man and you were chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, the Muslims, the Qazi and his soldiers, they wanted to give you so much punishment because they didn't like that the Muslim brother is taking the process of Hindu Dharma. So they requested you to give up Hindu Dharma and accept the Muslim Dharma. No. Otherwise, we will punish you. But Haridas says, oh, you converted so many into Hindus to Muslim, and now one Muslim became a Hindu. What is the great loss? Only one Muslim became a Hindu. So there's no big loss. And after all, we all worship the same Lord. You call him Allah the Great, and we call him, and the Hindus call him Hari or Krishna. But it's the same Lord, just with different name. So what is the great crime behind it? Then the Qazi somehow, he thought, because he was learned in the scriptures. He was reasonable. But then later on he became influenced of one of his servants and who influenced him, to actually punish this Haridas because he deviated from their culture. He's too dangerous. So he should be beaten on 22 marketplaces. 22 marketplaces, with stick. That's the Muslim way of how they punish somebody. Beating on the soles of your feet, or on the back. So on so many times. Why 22 marketplaces? Because on the first marketplace, they became so tired because Haridas didn't die. He didn't surrender. He was still chanting Hari Hari or Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. He didn't give up chanting. He didn't praying for his life. Please save me. I will become a Muslim. Allah Akbar. No, he went on chanting. And these soldiers who were punishing him, they became so much tired, they brought him in second marketplace, then a third one, then a fourth one. And ultimately to 22 marketplaces they were beating him. Still, he didn't die. Then what happened? Then the soldiers requested Haridas, why you don't die? Why you don't die? Please die. Because only when you die, The Kasi will not punish us. Otherwise, if you not don't die, if you will not convert yourself again to Islam, then we will be punished and we have to die. And then what Haridas did? Haridas, he actually always prayed for the mercy for others. He didn't want to see others suffering. Therefore, he was saying, "Oh, sorry. If you have to suffer because of me, I'm gladly die." Lord Chaitanya revealed this scene, this incident to Haridas Thakur, and he told, actually, I when I saw that a super soul, I saw what this man did to you. And I was ready to manifest myself and kill them, punish them. But when I heard your merciful cry and prayer for their savement, that you actually forgive them and that you want to save them, I could not kill them. Therefore, I could only do one thing. I was in myself, I protected you so that you could tolerate all the beads. From the stripe of these sticks, you know. And then Lord Chaitanya showed his own back, you know, and then all the marks of the sticks were on his back. When Haridas saw that, you know, he cried and he felt unconscious on the ground. He couldn't understand, oh, the Lord is so merciful to save even and protect even such a low servant of him. Although I don't deserve it. So he was always in this position. So therefore, Haridas Thakur, he was very dear to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And was personally present then when Haridas Thakur gave up his body. So therefore, for a devotee, it's for sure, the Lord knows everything and guides everything for all living entities. What to speak of his devotees who are surrendering and praying to him and are well-wishing for others. The Lord definitely will do something to fulfill the desire of his devotees. Although the Lord maybe would punish somebody, but if a devotee prays for somebody, Krishna will accept such a person or will not punish him. So in this way, we can see how Krishna is always helping the devotees and is guiding them in spiritual life also to make further and further progress. Because if one takes shelter one time at the lotus feet of Krishna and telling, from this day on I belong to you, Krishna says, I'm not, the devotee is not responsible anymore for his own life. I will personally take care for him. Not only in this life, life after life. Even if one has to take birth again, Krishna will guide him further. So there's never a loss. Everyone is guided further. In one way or another. For higher lives or lower lives, or for same life, similar lives again and again. As Krishna says, those who live in passion, they will take birth in animal forms. Human forms, those who are in ignorance, they will take birth in animal forms, lower species, and those who are in goodness, they will live in demigod forms. So it is ultimately the super soul who gives you this remembrance and the time of death or after death, who will guide you further to next bodily form and ultimately also to the place where there is no more birth, to go back home, back to Godhead, to the spiritual world, to take shelter at Krishna's lotus feet, the ultimate shelter. Okay. Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki. Is there any question? Prabhu, you were sleeping again? Three quarter of the class this time? Last time half the class? Not? Everything here? Can you come here? Because of fan, you know, I can not hear acoustically.
How does Krishna give?
Huh?
How does Krishna give remembrance, knowledge, and forgetfulness? I would have thought that the act of remembering and forgetting would be conducted by the modes of material nature.
No, the modes of nature cannot give you remembrance and forgetfulness in itself. Because the modes of nature, maya tyakshena prakriti suya che characharacharan, the modes of nature are agents. It's Krishna's energy. So let's say a certain policeman puts you in prison. But this, ultimately it's not the policeman who is putting you in prison, it is the government, the president of the country, who puts you in prison through the policeman. The policeman is just his representative. So ultimately, the sanctioner who is telling that you have to go in prison is the law book, the constitution and law book of a country, and the supreme government, you know. And they have representatives. So ultimately, it is because of them. You're there, although somebody else put you there. Right? Yeah, Mataji, right? Now you?
No.
You wanted to say?
Well, I was saying that when you go to sleep, you still take in the information.
Yeah, yeah. I know him, you know, I like him very much. I'm only mocking him a little, you know, all the time. He's a steady attendant of our Bhagavad Gita club. So that's a big award for you, you know. So because you are always coming, even you're sometimes a little sleeping. But I'm mocking him, you know, he's okay. Because he listens through the super soul, you know, in yoga nidra. That's the best hearing. Sometimes we seem to be hearing very much, very attentively, but if I ask you what you heard, you know, oh, so I don't remember. And then you, if I will ask you, maybe you can remember so many things. So don't be afraid, I will not ask. Yeah?
Prabhu, you said that Bhaktivinoda was on a transcendental level and even he would see all the suffering as mercy of Krishna. So how can I see whatever suffering I go at my level intuitively and understand, but how to practically see it as mercy of Krishna?
You don't have to see it. You have to understand it. You can see through understanding. So you hear from spiritual master, from devotees, from scriptures, from lectures, from reading Srila Prabhupada's books. You can learn how to understand, you know, that actually everything what is going on in your life is Krishna's mercy. Even if it seems to be negative, because we can learn, even from negative situation, how to become detached. Ultimately, the goal is to become detached from the bodily attachments. But if everything is going on nicely with your body and in your life, you know, you become more and more attached. Then you think, oh, life is very beautiful, it's very nice, why should I give it up? Therefore, Krishna makes this kind of arrangement through material nature. Material nature is Krishna's agent. Intellect also, mind, senses, devatas, they're all instrumental, the gunas. Three modes of material nature, the material elements, everything is instrumental of the Lord. There's no grass who can move without the will of the Lord. Of course, we think something else is the cause, but we don't see the cause behind that cause. We only see the cause what we can see. But the ultimate cause, we cannot find out by our on our own, by our own observation, therefore we have to learn from scriptures, Shruti. Therefore, scriptures, Shruti. Shruti Praman, the proof is hearing from scripture through the medium of spiritual master. That's how we can learn about our life, about God, our identity, duty, purpose of life, goal of life. All is explained. All is revealed. And everything, and very interesting, everything becomes revealed in due course of time. Not everything at once. Because when you not get too much, if you give somebody too much information, if he is not ready, that person, then what he will do with it? Therefore, Krishna only gives you that information what you need on the time. And then next time he give you more. Never too much. And also we should not be eager to get too much information, too much knowledge. Because this too much knowledge and information only bewilders us. Because we are not capable, you know, to digest all this information of the Vedas. Like Srila Prabhupada mentioned in one class, the Vedas are so elaborate, the Vedic scriptures, with all its supplements, that if you will read every day, 24 hours a day, you will never come to an end. You cannot make it in this long lifetime. Finish all study of these scriptures. You know that? 24 hours study you can do until the rest of life. You don't come to an end to read all the books of Vedic knowledge. But it's also not needed, as I already mentioned, because we have Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, these books are sufficient. So if you regularly recite and hear and contemplate or meditate about these books, Bhagavatam and Gita, then everything will become clear. Even if it is not clear now. Maybe now you are not ready to understand it, but if you continue with the process, Krishna will give you the intelligence to understand. He will give you the knowledge for it, that you can understand it. And also the proper, consciousness that you can receive it. Because we need sometimes the proper connection, you know, like radio station, you know, you need a channel. If the channel is not very clear, you know, then you have two channels in the same time, and then you hear a lot of noises, craziness. Don't understand anything. But if the channel is clear, connected, Radio Krishna Centrale, Radio Krishna Central, then if you are connected to Krishna, with Radio Krishna, direct line, parampara, then everything will become clear, very clear. If you read Prabhupada's books, everything is clear. If you read some other books, you know, everything becomes more and more unclear. Like sometimes I think, oh, I want to go and see as many temples here in Vrindavan and in the Holy Dhamma as much as possible. But ultimately, when you come to Krishna Balaram Mandir, then you say, oh, this is the best. Everything is clear here.